Good morning. Welcome to the Ethical Humanist Society of the Triangle. Thank you for coming out to the meeting today. The Ethical Humanist Society of the Triangle promotes the use of reason and... Are we ready? Settle down. The Ethical Humanist Society of the Triangle promotes the use of reason and science in the search for and commitment to living an ethical life that benefits humanity. We believe in personal inquiry, responsibility, and accountability, and that they are the best bases for ethical decision making. Our weekly forums seek to broaden our understanding of ethics and human nature, and our congregational community encourages us to share diverse opinions, friendship, and camaraderie. We welcome everyone to share in our journey. If you'd like more information about our community, please let me know following the platform. We'll also have a visitor sign-in sheet and some literature at the greeters table. We hope you'll find it helpful. So we are a community, and so we take time to share joys and sorrows. Mike. Oh, well, that's good.
Okay. It wasn't COVID, thanks to the free tests we got right here. Meanwhile, war in Ukraine, 1 year anniversary, still going on.
I had the pleasure of helping Mary Lockhart on her way to her new community at Galway Ridge. I was helping her pack yesterday. She hasn't been around for a while. She says hello to everybody. She's doing well on her schedule. She hopes to be all packed up in her house by the end of tomorrow. And she has another week before she moves in to do all the last minute stuff that takes to get there. So she's looking forward to her new place.
Well, glad to hear she's doing well.
Next Friday is our 44th wedding anniversary.
Oh.
We have an exciting trip to Raleigh planned to hear the Mozart Requiem.
Oh, where are you going to hear that?
Us at Raleigh.
Oh. Anyone else?
Great.
Here's sort of an announcement, Joy. I heard that Tallulah's restaurant in Chapel Hill is running a fundraiser tomorrow night for the victims of the earthquake in Turkey. So all the proceeds are going to go to, I think it's called A Bridge to Turkey. So Tallulah's, yeah. So we need some opening words. Jay's going to give us some.
Thank you, Linda. As I always try to do, add a little levity and humor to the topic, and there's no topic like death that needs more humor. And so these are some observations that fit in with the business of dying. Woody Allen famously once said, "It's not that I'm afraid to die. I just don't want to be there when it happens." Someone named Clarence Day, and I didn't Google that person, said, "If you don't go to other men's funerals, they won't go to yours." This is from an unknown author that I had heard in a different version before, maybe some of you had. This person reflected, "When I die, I want to pass peacefully like my grandfather. He died quietly in his sleep, not screaming like all the passengers on his bus. Here's a true story. Some years ago, I think it was in the early 90s, a man wrote a best-selling book called 100 Things to Do Before You Die. Then there were some spinoffs after that. Everybody came up with their own bucket list. But his book suggested things like running with the bulls in Pamplona, bungee jumping, scuba diving. Guess how he died? He accidentally tripped on his hall carpet and hit his head on the wall at home. That's how he went. He was 47 when that happened. And I guess he'd only gotten through about half of the things on his 100 list bucket list. And now here's a little reflection on death. It's a little joke. After a preacher died and went to heaven, he noticed that a New York cab driver had been awarded a higher status than he. He was concerned, so he said, "I don't understand," he complained to God. "I devoted my entire life to my congregation." God explained, "Our policy here in heaven is to reward results. Now, was your congregation well engaged whenever you gave a sermon?" The minister scratched his head and he had to admit, "Well, some of the time, some people fell asleep while I was preaching." "Exactly," said God. "And when people rode in this man's taxi cab, they not only stayed awake, they even prayed." Thanks.
Oh, nothing like humor. So I am going to be introducing our speaker too. So Charles Dorothy was a lawyer, and I'm sure he retains almost all of that knowledge. We're glad to have him speaking today. I suspect he was from South Dakota. He went to the University of South Dakota, and he went to law school there. And then he was in private practice in Rapid City, South Dakota. And then he was the assistant attorney general for the state of South Dakota. And then he was criminal prosecutor for a county in South Dakota called Minnehaha County. And then from 1980 to 1921, he was engaged in private practice in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. But during that time, he got into mediation, which I think is very interesting. And he was even licensed in Minnesota and Florida. And maybe he will tell us why he left South Dakota and went to Minnesota and Florida. But he was actually a member of the South Dakota Bar Association of Alternative Dispute Resolution. And after 2000, his practice focused on assisting clients with the acquisition, management, and disposition of assets. This included planning for death, disability, or retirement of an owner of a private business, utilizing owner buy-sell agreements, power of attorney, wills, and revocable trusts. So this should be a very interesting talk. Welcome, Charles.
Thank you. You actually read my biography. Good start.
Okay, so I want to visit with you about disability planning. It isn't death yet, but it's just a precursor. So what is disability planning? It's signing a thoughtful, well-prepared power of attorney that avoids a guardianship. What's a guardianship? Well, that's a legal proceeding where somebody sues you to have you declared to be incompetent, and a judge decides whether you are, and if you are, then they appoint a guardian to handle your affairs, and you're not in charge of your affairs anymore. That's a very expensive and very public process. You are in a public courtroom, and whatever embarrassment there may be about your mental condition or physical condition is all laid out for the looky-loos and anybody else to observe. So, why is it important to execute a power of attorney? To avoid that. To avoid the costly public nature of a guardianship. So who can commence a guardianship proceeding against you? Family member, an acquaintance, anyone concerned about your care or how you're handling your money. Healthcare provider. The ethics of healthcare providers are they can't provide you health services without your informed consent. Well, how do they get your informed consent if you're not able to give it? If you don't have a power of attorney that you can hand to that charge nurse so she can put it in your file, and the docs know that your son Bill has the authority to make decisions for you, they go to a clinical social worker and they say, we've got someone who does not have a power of attorney and I don't believe has the skills to give me informed consent. What happens? They hire the attorney that the hospital has on retainer or guardianships, and they proceed to get a guardianship. They sue you and have a determination by a judge as to whether or not you're competent to handle your affairs. And if you're not, somebody gets appointed a guardian. That's the only way the medical community can protect themselves from lawsuits, that you provided care to me without getting my informed consent. Creditors, you're not paying your bills, you got money, but you've kind of become a bit loony, and they want their money, and you won't give them the money. They can seek a guardianship over you and get control of your assets. The Veterans Administration can do it for vets. If they are concerned that a vet is not doing well and family members are taking advantage of them in any way, they have the power and authority to bring a veteran's guardianship action against you. Now, financial institutions and other persons and business entities that are doing business with you cannot and should not allow a family member to handle your affairs. I mean, how do they know that you have the authority to handle your brother's affairs? They're not going to transfer funds. They're not going to cash a CD. They're not going to do anything with those assets unless there's a power of attorney or a certified copy of a guardianship order. So, what are your costs of guardianship? Any of you been through a guardianship here? You're going to look at least $2,500 in attorney's fees, even if the guardianship is not contested. Well, how can it be that much? Well, the attorney that you hire to do a guardianship has a number of investigative things that he or she has to do, because the form that you fill out is, you know, what's this person's health conditions? Where are they living? What are their finances? And then they have to work first with the family to see if there's a family member that's willing to step up and help. And maybe help resolve interfamily disputes, because I think I'm better at it than my brother Bill, and so I ought to be it, not Bill. And once the family has somebody to step up and do this, and sometimes no one will, well, then he's got to call the bank trust officer and say, look, I got somebody that what we believe is incompetent. They seem to have some assets. Can't get a family member who's willing to handle their financial affairs. Would you act as a guardian for them? So there's a lot of preparation that attorney needs to go through, time spent to be able to even file the petition. Then, of course, there's a hearing. quite often, physicians become involved, licensed psychologists or psychiatrists, people who are trained in ascertaining a person's mental acuity and skills. So you have a contested guardianship where somebody sues you for guardianship and you're saying, brother, I don't think I'm that bad. I think I'm doing okay. You stay in your house, I'll stay in mine. You're going to pop up into the $7,500 range very quickly. I mean, you got two attorneys billing you $300 to $400 here in the Triangle area. you're hiring a licensed psychologist to do testing on you to ascertain what your mental skills are. You're talking to a psychiatrist, perhaps. Are we dealing with a mental illness? Are we dealing with some kind of diminished mental skills? What are we dealing with here? And you're subpoenaing people. You're subpoenaing the neighbor who saw you walk outside in your underwear and pee in the bushes, or go to the grocery store and take your shirt off and pray. Schizophrenic, so losing touch with reality. Well, the neighbor doesn't want to go in and testify about that stuff, so the lawyer will subpoena them. They'll get a subpoena at 2 o'clock. You're going to show up in the courthouse in Raleigh, and you're going to testify about what this guy said and did. How else can the judge know that you've lost your skills? If a legal dispute arises between you and the court-appointed guardian, where you think they're overstepping their bounds, you can handle some things, and they don't need to handle those for you. You're racking them up at probably $2,000 a hearing, $2,000 a petition. If a dispute arises between your guardian and your family, saying, I don't think you're taking good care of my dad. I mean, I want to see an accounting. You're not doing well. I can do better. Do the math, about $2,500 a time. Now, guardians have a right to be paid for their services. Even if it's a family member, they're performing a service. And they're required by statute to provide you an accounting and your family an accounting of not only your assets and how they were expended in the last year, but your health situation. Where are you living? What are your health issues? Who are your physicians? It's a fairly detailed reporting that has to be given in a guardianship. So this requires your guardian to either look through medical records themselves and consult with physicians and healthcare professionals yourself, or hire somebody. A nurse, a lot of nurses will help you go through medical records and do a summary of what medical care has been given in the last year to your father. It requires them to have somebody prepare a tax return, and it requires them to probably have somebody putting the numbers into a software program that generates an income and expense statement so you can see, you know, where what money came in and what money went out. And all of that costs money. Then there is a hearing. You're in front of a judge. You may have the tax return preparer there. You might have a neighbor there. You might have a clinical psychologist there. Let me give you an insight in the world I lived in. Physicians don't want to sit around like you sit around waiting for them. They don't want to sit around outside the courthouse to testify. They say, you want my testimony, you come to my office after I'm done with my patients, and you pay me $500 an hour, and you pay a court reporter, and you take a deposition, and you have a transcript or a video. I'm not coming into a public courthouse and sitting there. So most likely, you're paying for a videographer, You're paying for a court reporter who's taking down a word-for-word transcript. And I'm talking just the videographer and the transcript, $750 to $1,000. The doc, I've been charged up to $5,000 for a consultation. So it's expensive if you want testimony of a physician in a courtroom. So how does this power of attorney avoid all that? Well, it uses simple contract law. It uses simple principal and agent law that's been around for hundreds of years. I, as the principal, can give you as the agent the authority to do things for me. And if I have that in writing, then the other person can rely on that. And that is how a person carries out all kinds of activities through an agent. It's a power of attorney. Now, North Carolina statute has separate forms for a power of attorney for healthcare and a power of attorney for financial matters. Not sure why they do that. I practiced in South Dakota. We had conservatorships that handled financial matters, guardianships that only handled personal matters, and we had powers of attorney that handled both. But here they separate them. And in reading through the forms, it's clear that there are very different issues with a healthcare power of attorney than a financial power of attorney. And different people can hold those. For example, you may be very comfortable with your spouse handling the power of attorney regarding your healthcare matters, but he's had some alcohol problems, he's had some spending problems, and when he drinks, who knows what's going to happen to the money. So I'm happy with him making decisions about whether I'm in a nursing home or not, but not where my money is. And maybe you have a daughter that's a CPA who's much better equipped to handle the financial aspects than your spouse is. It could be a little bit of mental impairment. It could be any sort of mild mental illness that he or she could be facing. So you can have a different person handling your financial matters from your personal matters. So who do you want to be the agent named in your power of attorney? You need to do some thinking about that one. Family members are the ones we usually first think about, but some people just don't have a good relationship with their family for whatever reason. I mean, not only their children, if they have any, but extended relatives. They may have a significant other that they are more comfortable with. But even if you choose your children, don't do the old, oh, I'll just give it to the first male of the family thing. I mean, figure out who it is that has a little bit of skill within the familial group so that they don't anger everyone and can take care of some disputes and know that there are sibling rivalries and that sort of thing. So you really need to think about that. And I've had a number of clients say, look, I want my CPA to do it. I mean, she's handled my financial stuff and my accounting and a lot of my projections for years and years and years. I trust her implicitly, and I don't have any of my kids that I want to turn my money over to. And so I'll give my husband the power of attorney over my health care, but I want my CPA to handle the money. You can do that. You can separate it. Should the power of attorney be conditional on your inability to handle your own affairs? Well, there's a dispute among lawyers as to whether a power of attorney should be effective immediately when it is signed, or if it's only effective if you become disabled. If it becomes effective immediately, it's easier for people to deal with your power of attorney holder, physicians, banks, whoever it might be, because there isn't any condition on it. If you come in with a power of attorney and you cash in a CD and you handed them a power of attorney, they're off the hook. I mean, they're not liable if you misappropriate that. the attorneys who believe that it's best to have a power of attorney conditioned on you being disabled, is why should you give somebody else the authority to handle your affairs, even your spouse, when you can do it yourself? And then they argue back and forth. Well, but how do you resolve when you're disabled? I mean, if you make a contingent on disability, what are you spending $10,000 in the courtroom trying to figure out, you know, whether or not they're disabled? Docs can't wait for that. Bankers can't wait for that. So here's a simple example of the danger of an unconditional power of attorney. And I could give you dozens of them. A gal that's a chief financial officer for a company flies to New York for a week-long conference and comes back and finds the CD of $50,000 that was in her name was cashed in by her husband, who holds her power of attorney, and he went on a drunk and a cocaine trip to Las Vegas and came back with $50. Military guys and gals go overseas, come back, the house is gone. I never authorized you to sell the house. I had a power of attorney, unconditional. So one of the things that you probably should do, if you how many of you have powers of attorney? Okay. And so a few of you don't. Well, those of you that do, you should go back and reread them and see, is it conditional or not? Okay. And if it isn't, then you need to, if it is conditional upon you becoming disabled, you need to specify, how does that disability get determined? Because if you, was that? Yours is two doctors. So what two doctors does the person helping you go to? Are they psychiatrists? Are they trained? Are they licensed psychologists trained in cognitive impairment? Or are you just going to a GP who's probably going to say, outside my line of work, why don't you go get a licensed psychologist to do that? I'm a general practitioner. Plus, I don't want to be adverse to my client. I don't want to be giving testimony against my client. I'm really uncomfortable with that. And the form you have is probably the North Carolina form, because that is the form that I looked at yesterday, and that's what it does. It says that you can go to two physicians or to two licensed psychologists or a combination, and they'll give you something in writing. Well, that's one way to do it. The other way is to say in your power of attorney, if there is a dispute as to whether or not I am disabled, I want it to be determined in a mediation, not in litigation. All right, so I need to teach you some things. If you don't, how many of you know what mediation is? Okay, a few of you. Mediation is a consensual process where someone called a mediator sits down with the parties in dispute, helps them identify what are you disputing about. I mean, if we have things you agree on, let's write it down on a piece of paper. If we have things you're disputing about, let's write that down on a piece of paper, and let's tackle each one of these disputes and see if we can find some way that we all can come to an agreement. Yeah, that will work to resolve that dispute. Arbitration is an ADR, alternative dispute resolution process. It's private judging. You hire a lawyer and you go into a room and you have a lawyer, and the other side has a lawyer, and you try a case. You bring in witnesses, you put them under oath, the arbitrator makes a decision, and that's how it's resolved. Okay. If a person... Oh, you got it. Because then you can't hear me. I better not wander around. Mediation can help resolve disputes between who you gave the power of attorney to, about how they're handling it, whether or not they should become effective, if that person is capable of still making rational decisions. If they can, if they've really lost touch with reality, they have Alzheimer's, they're schizophrenic and are not there part of the time, it won't work. I mean, don't even go into mediation. It requires thoughtful people trying to resolve a dispute between themselves. But arbitration and a lawsuit in a courthouse will most likely destroy whatever good, loving relationship you had with that person. It's adversarial. Dad, you're disabled. You're so long gone that I'm going to take over your affairs. Mom, it's finally happened. You've gone nuts. You are incompetent. What harsh words. What harsh concepts. Mediation is much better suited to have that person begin to understand that they've got some problems here. And that they have people that care about them and are willing to help. So they need to yield a little bit of that control that has always been such a part of it. Litigation doesn't do that. Litigation destroys relationships. It makes a decision, all right. But any affection that probably existed in the family setting will be gone. So what constitutes a disability? Well, in North Dakota, it's spelled out by statutes. The inability of an individual to manage property or business affairs because the individual has any of the following statuses. One, an impairment in the ability to receive and evaluate information or make or communicate decisions, even with the use of technological assistance. What that doesn't address is the often gray area that, look, I can do my own dishes. I can get my own groceries. I mean, give me $400 or $500 in my account. I like to go down and buy a cigar and sit on the bench or go to a movie. But yeah, I need help figuring out whether or not I should be cashing in CDs or where I ought to be living. It's those gray areas that I have seen so often be so difficult to resolve. Mediation does a much better job at resolving that than litigation does. And then it gets into what you experienced, which is a personal examination by two physicians or a licensed psychologist or both. And then it has some strange language to me, by an attorney at law. Well, I was an attorney at law. I would never have expected somebody to say, well, will you testify that mom is incompetent? She's my client. I mean, I'm not supposed to do things adverse to her interests. And I may have to represent her if you guys push too far and she thinks that she's okay. So this whole concept that attorneys who have law licenses somehow have the ability to decide whether or not you're disabled, to me as an attorney, is absurd. I wouldn't take on that responsibility, and I don't want it. Or a judge. Well, then you're in a courtroom, aren't you? I mean, how do you get a judge to determine your incompetence unless you petition the judge and file some pleading and get into a courthouse so that the judge has a hearing? You know, then what are you doing? Are you in a guardianship? Or an appropriate government official? I'm lost. I mean, does a secretary of the Assistant Secretary of Agriculture We get to decide whether or not a farmer applying for some help is, I don't understand where any of that comes from. I understand the physicians. I better understand the licensed psychiatrists or psychologists. I don't understand this attorneys at law or government official. And think about this, two physicians, putting the cost of that, it's going to be a minimum of 1,000. It might be 5,000. It's going to be expensive for you to get to somebody who's comfortable giving an opinion about your mental capacity. And they're going to charge you a fee, and it'll bang your pocketbook pretty good. But if your power of attorney says that any questions of your disability will be determined quickly and cost effectively through a private alternative dispute resolution process, then it will be. It won't be in the court system. It won't be in a guardianship. It'll be done privately in a doctor's office or an attorney's office. And it will be much, much less expensive than litigation. Now, what are the downsides of using ADR? Well, it's cost again. I mean, if you do an arbitration, you're hiring a lawyer to be a private judge, and it'll probably be a $5,000 bill before he or she is done hearing testimony, preparing findings of fact, conclusions of law, reading the law, thinking about, well, how should this come out? And you got your own attorney because you're in litigation, and the person you're opposing has an attorney, and your attorney's fees are just racking up all the while you're doing that. Mediation avoids that. You have one mediator, and you work with that mediator to try to find a mutually agreeable resolution to whatever your dispute is. You asked a question I want to answer. Why in the world did an attorney from South Dakota go to Minnesota to get a license? And then to Florida. Well, I went to Florida because I started spending my winters in Florida in the last 10 years of my practice and wanted to make money. But the reason I went to Minnesota is South Dakota has absolutely no certification for mediators. The Bar Association, controlled by the judiciary and the trial lawyers, do not want mediation. The Bar Association members who were mediating had to force their way into a committeeship with the South Dakota Bar Association, said, well, at least let us meet as mediators and we can begin educating some of you guys about why we ought to be using mediation. And I sat on that committee for 5 years. South Dakota is not terribly unusual out in the West. There's an idea, a philosophy, well, judges are trial lawyers that, that are skilled, they really know what they're doing, we'll just yield to them and they'll try these cases, and we have a court system, so we ought to be using that court system. Minnesota has always been different from South Dakota, North Dakota, Wyoming, Nebraska, a very progressive state. They embraced alternative dispute resolution, in particular mediation. 25 years ago, when a chief justice signed an order that said you cannot file a petition to have a trial unless you have attended at least a day of mediation with a mediator that we've trained. That's what Minnesota does. And it just sliced all the number of these, all kinds of cases, all kinds of civil cases. South Dakota has never done that. It has never empowered the attorneys without a judge there to work with clients and come up with solutions to disputes. It's all got to be reserved. It all has to be done, resolved at the courthouse. So here's one of the points I want to make to you. In North Carolina, if your power of attorney doesn't say that I want this resolved first by mediation, if possible, and if not, then I want it done privately by arbitration, you're going to be in the judicial proceeding. And if you don't say, I want my power of attorney to be contingent upon my disability, then you have given that agent the authority right now, even though you don't agree, you don't consent, to deal with all of your assets. So that's one of the biggest decisions any of you working with powers of attorney have to address, is do I want it to be contingent on disability or not? Now, here's an interesting thing to me. In the guardianship statutes, in the Uniform Guardianship Act that North Carolina has adopted, the guardian should only do for the ward, which is the name of the person that's been declared incompetent, what the ward can't do for themselves. I mean, this disability can be a multifaceted thing. I may not be good with math, but I still know what church I want to go to, or I still know where I want to live. I still want to know who my friends are. And so the guardianship statute specifically says something that the power of attorney statute does not, and I think should. And here it is. The agent shall exercise authority only to the extent necessitated by principal's limitations, and shall encourage the principal to the extent principal is able to, one, participate in decisions regarding principal's affairs, two, act on principal's own behalf, three, develop or regain the capacity to manage principal's health care, living arrangements, assets, business affairs, and financial affairs. And I could give you a dozen examples. Chris has a stroke, and it bangs him up pretty good, just like the senator that's now struggling with that. And so for a while, he needs help. And somebody using the power of attorney is handling his affairs. But then he recovers. And now there's a struggle. I mean, he thinks he's okay. And his daughter or her wife thinks, no, you're not, Chris. I mean, I got to keep doing this. How do you resolve that dispute? Answer, try mediation. Do not litigate against your spouse. Do not litigate against your dad. Many powers of attorney do not contain this language because it isn't in the form. And so there are going to be disputes that develop that end up in litigation because you don't have that provision. So the issue really is assistance or control. Mental skills often diminish incrementally over time. Often an elderly person can still handle some aspects of their life, even though they need assistance with others. Assisting an elderly person through the journey from some mental impairment to complete mental impairment requires frequent contact so that you know if you're the agent, so you know how they're doing. You know what they need. It can't be done from a distance. It requires family, friends, caregivers, sometimes consultation with a non-litigious lawyer. The challenge for the elderly person and the agent is whether the elderly person just needs a little help or if they really need you to do it for them. So what am I talking about? Let's get into real life. Paying bills, handling your checkbook, making decisions on whether or not a CD should be reinvested, making a decision as to how much you should draw out of your simplified employee pension plan. living arrangements. I want to move to another place. I want to move to a 55 plus community where I have some friendship with a little bit more mature people. A lot of times, older people need assistance with that, but they don't need for you to do it for them. And conflicts can develop in this very area. Can you imagine the amount of money you're going to take if you sue your dad every time you think that he ought to live in one place and he thinks he ought to live in another? Don't do it. I mean, that's really my message. Find a non-litigious attorney that does mediation and see if you can't sit with him in a couple of sessions and get this worked out. Mediation with its collaborative and non-adversarial basis and the fundamental principle of self-determination of the parties is well suited to assist in resolving those kinds of disputes. Litigation is not. This journey regarding healthcare and living arrangements can include conflicts over, should I be driving anymore? I mean, I had an accident and I wasn't very careful and I'm getting older. I can't see as well. And I don't want to give up my independence. My experience has been asking a person who has been independent their whole life to give up driving is a very difficult conversation. Handling your own checkbook. I've reconciled my checkbook for 42 years. I don't need to have you do it for me. Well, then why are you overdrawn, Dad? Let's have a talk about that. Handling the bills. No, I've been handling the bills. Dad and I had a portfolio system. We always paid our bills. Well, then why are there overdue notices here on the table, Mom? Entering into contracts. Well, I see elderly people that have minimal skills left entering into contracts to buy vehicles, to lease properties long-term, to buy real estate, to invest in stocks and bonds. And they just really need some help with that. Charitable gifting. I've given 10% to the church since 1952. Well, maybe, Mom, but all you have now is Social Security. I mean, you and Dad were making $85,000 a year. Back in the 70s, you could do that. Right now, you're taking 10% of a Social Security amount, and here's your rent, here's your food. I'm not trying to stop you from being charitable to your church, but let's take her down to 1% or something. Should this person continue to live at home? Or is it time to either bring in a nurse on some kind of a partial basis or full-time basis? Go to an assisted living center, go to a nursing home. Tough, tough personal decisions for the elderly. You have to be patient with them, but you have to be firm. Because if they're not eating, if they're not keeping up their living situation, they're not cleaning themselves, you have to step in, but you have to do it in a way that doesn't offend them. These are very emotional issues for any elderly client that I've ever represented and helped through. These issues are best dealt with through education, counseling, collaboration, not through litigation. Okay, next issue. Should your power of attorney state that your agent should provide an accounting to you and to others you designate? Yes. Why? Because that prevents theft. It prevents misappropriation. It causes your daughter to know that I'd like to take $10,000 out because I'm behind on my house payments. But if I do, I got to report that to my brothers and to my mom. Reporting creates a situation where a person who might otherwise say, I can bend the rule here. I mean, I'll pay it back in 3 weeks. They don't do it at all. And that's the hope, that it prevents elder abuse, financial elder abuse. This is one of the most frequent areas of litigation in powers of attorney, is a family member taking the money, using it for their own purposes or for their kids' college tuition, and she'll get mom paid back, and she never does. And a lot of times when it comes up, if she dies, the money's gone, and the brothers and sisters want to know where their share is. And when you have an accounting written into your power of attorney, it eliminates that sibling thing of, well, why are you afraid to tell me, sis? I mean, why aren't you showing me where the money is? If you're not showing it to me, then you're hiding it. I mean, there's almost a normal human cynicism when a person is handling somebody's funds and it's a family member and they're not telling you what they're doing with it. Every kind of possible sibling rivalry, I think I've seen in these settings where the person who's handling it wants to totally control it, and other siblings aren't being given adequate insight into mom's care or her money or anything else. If you require it, then it's going to happen. It can be as simple as this: as agent shall provide principal and the following persons at least an annual report summarizing, one, what assets and liabilities the principal has, how agent handled principal's income and expenses since the last report, and three, principal's health condition, medical care, and living situation. And who do you send it to? You want it to send to you, to your spouse, to your children? You have to figure out who you want it to go to, but there should be a reporting requirement. The wording should be in there, because if it isn't in there, they may very well not report, and they'll end up in litigation, and the judge will have to say, why don't you share it with them? I mean, all you're doing is creating suspicion, so I'm going to order you to do it. Well, why don't you just tell them to do it in your document? Okay, can I name co-agents in my power of attorney? Yes, and you probably should. I mean, it's back to that thing, your daughter is a CPA, maybe a whole lot more skilled to handle your financial matters than your husband, who's 10 years older than you are and experiencing some of his own mental limitations. And it's another way to reduce misappropriation. If you have two children, you name as co-powers of attorney, there's a lot less of a chance that one of them will decide, you know, I'm just going to take a little bit out for the kids' college education, because she has to sit there with her sister and make those decisions. You don't want too many co-agents, because I've been there, you know, four siblings around my conference room table who haven't gotten along in 20 years trying to decide what ought to happen to mom's CD. Just name a couple and tell them to account to their siblings, and then let the siblings chat away about it as they want to. Must the power of attorney be notarized? Yep, has to be notarized. They have to be witnessed? No, got to be witnessed by a notary. It's got to be notarized. When does it end? When does the power of attorney end? Well, when you die. A lot of people don't know that. And dad is gone, and you have his power of attorney. You're still trying to deal with stuff, pay his bills. That's not your job anymore. When he died, the power of attorney ended, and there has to be a probate representative. And many people get into litigation and legal disputes because they don't understand my power of attorney powers ends when the person who gave it to me dies. Or it ends when a judge appoints a guardianship. You've not been doing the right thing. You did take money out for your kid's college education. Your sister caught you. A lawsuit was brought, and the judge said, I'm appointing a guardian, I'm removing you, and I'm appointing your sister. Can you revoke your power of attorney? Yep, you can make as many of them as you want. You can make one every year if you want. Revoke the old one, bring in the new one. Can you nominate your guardian in your power of attorney? Yes, under North Dakota law you can. Why would that ever happen? Well, if somebody brings a guardianship proceeding and you're the agent for the person being accused of being incompetent, if the judge for some reason says, well, yeah, I think a guardianship would be better than a power of attorney, you're still not removed. Your mother named you as the guardian to be appointed if one was ever needed, so your siblings can fight all they want to, but if the judge takes a look at this and says this person was competent and nominated this person as my guardian, it eliminates guardian disputes and litigation. Should you sign a health care directive stating whether you want to be kept alive with heart and lung machines or artificial nutrition and hydration if you're brain dead? Yes. Do not leave that decision to your family. It's a horrible ethical mess. I've seen the most loving siblings break down over this. No, keep her alive. Keep mom alive. Keep dad alive. But his brain isn't there anymore. He's gone. What? Why are we doing that? Horrible personal ethical choices. Then tell him. Tell him in a healthcare directive what you want done. If you're brain dead and obviously unable to handle your own affairs, do you want to be sustained on machinery? If you don't, you need to say so, or you will be. So I want to talk to you about Terry Schiavo. Any of you know that name? Okay. Let me tell you the story of Terry Schiavo for those of you who don't know it. On February 25th, 1990, at age 26, Terry went into cardiac arrest at her home in St. Petersburg, Florida. She had suffered from bulimia. She lost that battle. And her heart stopped. They resuscitated her, but she was brain dead. After 2.5 months without any improvement, her diagnosis had not changed. She was in a persistent vegetative state. She had no power of attorney. So on June 18th, 1990, court appointed her husband, Mike, as her power of attorney. Got to correct that, as her guardian. She had no power of attorney, so he was appointed guardian. And her parents at the time, Robert and Mary Schindler, had no objection. For the next 2 years, doctors tried to find some way to bring her back, occupational therapy, all different kinds of therapies, but there was no hope of her returning to any state of awareness. So in 1998, 8 years after she had gone into cardiac arrest, Michael petitioned the Sixth Judicial Circuit Court in Florida to allow him to remove her feeding tube. That's how she was alive. Her body was functioning, but she couldn't eat, so they had to feed her intravenously. That was opposed by Robert and Mary, who, as Catholics, believed in miracles, and they believed that God could heal her and treat her and bring her back to life. Michael procured a $750,000 judgment in a malpractice case that he brought against the physician who he felt didn't properly treat her bulimia and it led to her death. Put it into a trust. Judge ordered it be put in trust. But the bills were running at $80,000 a year. This was in 1990. By 1998, it was gone. $750,000 was gone to the hospitals for her being in intensive care. Well, where do we go here? Well, let's talk about money. Well, Michael is now responsible to pay for her care. You're responsible to pay for your spouse's care. He didn't have the money. And the doctor, they're saying, well, I can't, we can't bear the cost of this. What are you going to do? Robert and Mary, her parents, weren't responsible, but they didn't want to remove from the tubes. So Medicaid stepped in. Said, okay, I mean, she has no money. Her husband has no money. She needs health care. Medicaid will begin funding this. The judge decided that he could remove the feeding tube, that she would not have wanted to have lived that way. And what followed was, catch this, 14 appeals to the Florida Supreme Court, 5 federal lawsuits, hearings in the Florida legislature, hearings in the Congress, all dealing with the right to life. It's unclear who paid the legal fees for all of this litigation, but it would have been in the millions. There were amicus curiae briefs filed by various right to life groups, right to die groups. Most likely, the National Right to Die group helped Michael with some of the fees. And they did file amicus curiae briefs on his behalf. But ultimately, the ACLU stepped in and represented him in the rest of the litigation. 4 times, the United States Supreme Court upheld the Florida Circuit Court judge's ruling. March 23rd, 2005, I found an article in the Washington Post entitled "Schiavo Case Puts Face on Rising Medical Costs." It pointed out the tremendous cost of keeping brain-dead people in nursing homes and the inconsistency of the Republican leaders in both Florida. We're talking Jeb Bush at the time, Washington, D.C., George Bush's brother, and various right-to-life groups strongly supported by the Catholic Church. Wanting cutbacks in Medicaid, but wanting to keep Terry alive. Shortly after she was removed from life support, she passed away on March 31st, 2005. Think about the horribleness of her death. She starved to death. I mean, she was being artificially nutrited and hydrated, and they quit feeding her, and so she finally died of malnutrition. Bulimia really stayed with her whole life. All of that litigation, all of that political uproar, all of the 15 years of national news coverage, constantly hearing Terry Schiavo and seeing pictures of her lying in a bed, and that when they run the flashlight over her face, she followed it with her eyes so she wasn't brain dead. And all of that non-scientific nonsense that was in the news about her could have been avoided by a simple power of attorney and a healthcare directive. I want my husband, Mike, to have my power of attorney. And Mike, I don't want to be sustained artificially if I'm brain dead. It never would have happened. All of that would not have happened. So if you want to read up on that yourself, go to Wikipedia and look at Terry Schiavo case. It's a very detailed description chronologically of all the things that happened to her after she was in cardiac arrest and no longer had brain function. Okay. So I want to open it up to questions here. I mean, I have some other comments I'll make. I know we wanted to keep it 20 minutes. Chris, you said questions. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah.
I had a question. Rasha, how do we recognize?
So how much does mediation cost?
Mediation is going to cost you about $300 an hour. And most mediations last 4 to 6 hours.
So it's not cheap either.
No, it is not.
Mm.
I had a question.
How is power of attorney executed? I mean, do you take a, say you want to get your wife's $1,000 CD, you just take it to the bank and they read it and interpret how it should be executed, or?
Okay, let me see if I can answer. You and I are married, you fill out a power of attorney, you sign it, it's notarized, and I have a copy as your husband, and you go on that trip I talked about. I take the original power of attorney and I give it to the banker, and I say, okay, they'll look at it, determine that it's authentic, and I will be in the SED.
And if they read the mediation part, will they know what to do with that?
If that's in there, they would. Okay. If your power of attorney says that that this is conditional, I'm becoming disabled, then the banker could look at it and say, well, has there been a determination of the disability? And you could then say, well, here is a copy of the decision reached in mediation. Right. So the only time the bank would just take that power of attorney, release that CD, is if it is not contingent on your disability. Yeah. Because if you just sign the power of attorney form, for example, the North Carolina has, not contingent on your disability, that person can go in at any time and deal with your assets.
Other questions?
I have a question. Can you hear me?
Is there something that you could put in this document by accident that would void the whole document, or would just void the particular clause that you
put? Well, not notarizing it will mean it never was effective, but I can't think of a situation where you could say something that would void the whole document. I mean, you could say in there, if I get sick, I want my power of attorney holder to kill me. Well, they're not going to uphold that. But
it, yeah, because it's illegal, right?
Right. But it wouldn't invalidate the whole power of attorney.
So, and well, there are sort of standard powers of attorney that people sign, but you went into quite a bit of detail. How does one find the documents that have all this, how it should really be done? Because there are sort of standard power attorneys that people sign, that I've signed. And really, from what you said, it's not really that good. You should really be thinking better about it. So.
There's a dilemma when you decide I'm going to do a power of attorney. You can go on LegalZoom and for $100 do a power of attorney, but you're not getting any legal advice. I mean, it's not tailored to your situation, to your family, to what your interests are. But then if you go to an attorney that specializes in estate planning and powers of attorney, get your checkbook out, because it's going to be a couple $1,000s, and they're going to spend several hours with you walking through these various options, making sure you understand them, what you want to do. So do you want to do it on the cheap and maybe not have dealt with a lot of issues, or do you want to spend time with an attorney that has estate planning experience and get a more tailored power of attorney? Let me follow up with this. I'm not licensed anymore, guys. I mean, I practiced law for 47 years and retired and walked away. So I'm not the person to ask anymore. I mean, I'm just kind of educating you generally about powers of attorney and what I know about them. So how do you find somebody if you don't have somebody that can help you with a power of attorney? There are three areas that you can go to. You can go to lawyers.com. That is a website run by Martindale Hubbell that has a listing of attorneys, and they're rated by peer reviews. Pre-internet, Martindale Hubbell had this system where they had books for every state. And if I had somebody in North Carolina that I needed to hand in something for a client, I'd go to Martindale Hubbell and I'd go to probates and estate planning, and I would read through, and this guy specializes in powers of attorney, and he's rated quite highly by his peers. That's how, as an attorney, I would decide who I could send my client to. When the internet came into being, Martindale Hubbell said, we're going to survive. We got to go electronic. So they created lawyers.com. They do the same thing. You go to lawyers.com, look up me, there'll be a rating, and they'll be peer reviewed about the things they do. So that's one, lawyers.com. The other is findlaw.com. That's the West Publishing Company out of Minneapolis for years did the same thing Martindale Hubbell did. Now they're doing it through findlaw.com. And the third place is you can go to the North Carolina Bar Association website, search for estate planning and powers of attorney, and they'll give you all of the attorneys that have gone through a program to be certified as specialists in that area. So that's, you really shouldn't do it just by Googling. I think you're better off using vetted sites like lawyers.com, FindLaw, or the North Carolina Bar Association.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Yep.
Hey, we have an internet question.
Can you hear me?
Tova from our Zoom audience is asking regarding guardianship and creditors demanding to be paid, is it possible that they, the creditors, can garnish the income of the person? That is, it seems, would be a record of the declining ability of the person to pay bills.
Can they garnish? Yes.
What's that?
They can garnish the assets of a person who's in guardianship, yes.
Okay. What about power of attorney?
Same way.
Okay. Yeah.
The only way you're going to avoid that is bankruptcy.
Okay. All right, but does that answer the question? Okay. All right. I think she's saying yes.
No.
What other questions do we have?
I want to end with a real life story. I was contacted by a young man whose dad is a vet, came back from Vietnam, schizophrenic, in really trouble. When he was on his meds, he functioned okay and could even work. But when he went off his meds, he lost touch with the reality, and they'd have to go to Colorado and get him because he'd call them and say, you know, I'm on the street and downtown Denver and I don't have any money left, come and get me. And the banker, it was a small town, so the banker knew this guy, had gone to high school with him, knew his son, he had all of his money there, and his son wanted to buy a house, and he said, Dad, I'd really like to buy a house, but I don't have down payment money, will you help me? He said, sure, I will. And they went around, they found a house for him and his new wife. And he took $10,000 out of his dad's bank account. The banker knew it because he called the guy and said, is this okay? He said, sure. He went off his meds. He went up to the VA in Sioux Falls and said, my son's stealing from me. He stole $10,000 from me. So a VA social worker gets involved. A VA guardianship is brought. And we went through 2 days of litigation as to whether or not this son should be removed as his dad's power of attorney holder, because the VA was saying, we think this vet is involved in elder abuse. The judge ruled, because he had violated his ethical obligation not to take his dad's money without his dad's knowledge and consent, that he was not fit to be the power of attorney holder anymore. So they appointed a social worker with the VA to be his guardian. The next time I heard from my client, his dad had called him from some city somewhere out west. He'd gone off his meds. He was on the street and he wanted to come home. And he said, what do I do? I don't have power of attorney anymore. And I said, well, call up call up the guardian and tell them what happened. And he did, and he got back to me and he said, well, they said their caseload is so heavy, they don't have time to go out to pick my dad up and bring him back. I mean, that shows you how wrong the whole system can go in guardianships. Mm-hmm. So I hope you enjoyed my talk and feel very a little much. Bit smarter than you did before we started.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Those are your notes, huh? So these must be mine. So do we have a specific time we have to be out of this room today? 3:30. Okay. So, Jay, closing words. Oh, wait, I'm supposed to thank people first. And then we'll have closing words. Oh, announcements. Announcements? None. Oh, yes, Gretchen has an announcement.
In Pittsburgh this Wednesday at 6:00 at the Modern Life Deli, our alternate place, 6:00 at the Mod, and I'll be there. I hope somebody else will join me. Wednesday night, 6 to 8.
Thank you.
Next week, we will be having a video that we will play here. It'll be presented by the Center for Death Penalty Litigation. It's called Racist Roots, The Origins of North Carolina's Death Penalty. So it'll be a showing of about a 25-minute documentary followed by a Q&A session about that film. So we hope you can make it. It should be a good showing. Two people from the death penalty, from the Center for Death Penalty Litigation, will be here to answer your questions about that.
Thank you. Any other announcements? Okay. Gretchen, thank you for greeting today. Jay, thank you for opening and closing words. Thank you, Amy, for fixing some goodies for us. And thank you, Mike, for putting out the sign every week. We very much appreciate that. And who have I missed? Oh, Chris, thank you for manning the Zoom every week, too. Very much appreciated. Okay. Over to you, Jay.
I'm going to do something a little unusual because of the nature of the program and everything. And you know that most of you know that I'm very involved for years now in right to die issues, death with dignity and that kind of stuff. So I wanted to add something. It wasn't something I would question, but the case of Terry Schiavo was preceded by Karen Ann Quinlan and Nancy Cruzan. Those two ladies were both in their early 20s when they fell ill. And if you combine the years, they were involved in legal jousting before they were allowed to die. That was another 17 years between them. So we have a long history of things going wrong. And I work for one of the three national advocacy groups. One is Compassion and Choices. The other is Death with Dignity. And the one I belong to and volunteer for is Final Exit Network. And when we make presentations, we show a slide with those three young ladies and the total years that they were prevented from being delivered. And the message we said is they were all in their mid to early 20s. So it's never too early to start thinking about an advance directive. And when you want a medical advance directive, what they can or cannot do to you, all three of those national organizations have forms. They're going to be a lot better than you're going to get online. Now, it's not a power of attorney, but it'll tell the doctors and other healthcare providers what they can or cannot do. This is so important to our organization that we have what's almost a full-time surrogate consultant who you can call and ask questions about end-of-life issues with powers of attorney, surrogates, and everything. And one of the other things we say is it is so important to choose a surrogate, and you just can't assume that it can be a family member or somebody else. They got to be a bulldog They got to be somebody who's committed and is going to go to the mat for you and stand up to physicians and others. Okay. Oh, and I've got some brochures there on the table for Final Exit Network. If anybody's curious about what they do, pick one up and take it on the way out. And I won't even end with a dumb joke. I had one, and I'm apologizing for equating preparedness with death, but you got to be prepared by the time death arrives. Thank you.
Thank you, Jay. And I think we're ready for refreshments. Looks like everything's set up. Thank you, Amy. Oh, our meeting is over, but our fellowship continues.
I think that's all we need to say.